Hi all, welcome to Smart Catalyst, 5th February 2019. Today we'll be discussing these six topics. The first one is related with the recent report released by ICMOD. The second is related with the disaster risk management initiative being undertaken by Indian Ocean Rim Association. The third is the rising emission levels in India when compared with China. The fourth one is related with the extent of cancer spread in Southeast Asia. Fifth article is related with the recent controversy surrounding angel tasks. And the last one is related with the elephant corridors all over the country. Let's move to the first article. The first article is related with the recent report of ICMOD, that is International Center for Integrated Mountain Development. So it has released a new report, Hindu Kush Himalaya Assessment. Let's have a brief look into the assessment provided by ICMOD. ICMOD has released a report titled Hindu Kush Himalaya Assessment Report. In this assessment report, ICMOD has assessed the extent of glacial melting by the year of 2100. The report says that with increasing global warming, by the year of 2100, two-thirds of the glaciers in the Hindu Kush Himalayan region would become empty. This Hindu Kush Himalayan region is a most important geographical phenomenon. The Hindu Kush Himalayan region spreads across 8 countries, and the 8 countries include Afghanistan, Pakistan, India, Nepal, Tibet, China, Myanmar, Bhutan. Also, the Hindu Kush Himalayan region is the home for the glaciers. These glaciers act as a source for 10 important river systems in the world. The important river systems originating from Hindu Kush Himalayan ranges includes Amudarya, Indus, Tari, Ganges, Brahmaputra, Yellow, Yangtze, Airavadi, Mekong. Even in the perspective of protecting biodiversity, Hindu Kush Himalayan region becomes more important. The region has 4 biodiversity hotspots. So this significance of the Hindu Kush Himalayan region makes it geographically and environmentally important. Being the Yangfol mountain, Himalayas are always been fragile, and this ecological fragility is also evident with the growing risk of climate change all over the world. The ripple effect of this glacial melting would be seen on the rivers of South Asia. With the melting of glaciers due to global warming, the volume of water flowing in the river might increase, causing flood-like situation in many areas. Also, the loss of glaciers is not a recyclable phenomenon. It would be a permanent event. So the future of the perennial rivers along the South Asia becomes a question mark with the melting of glaciers. More than 250 million people are living in the hazard-prone mountain region, and there are around 1.65 billion people living along the river valley downstream. We all know that the vulnerability of a particular region and a natural hazard happening there defines the magnitude of a disaster. We all aware of the fact that vulnerability of a particular geographical region and happening of a natural hazard and defines the extent of disaster in a particular given region. With more than 250 million people living along the hazard prone area, the vulnerability increases and the probability of having a huge disaster is also increasing. So the government should be focusing on cutting down the emissions. The glacial melting is happening mainly along this Indo-Gangetic zone, and this Indo-Gangetic Doab area is known for high pollutants. The black carbon emanated from the industries located along the region, it goes and settles down in the snow, and this snow acts as settle downs on the snow, and these pollutants reduce the albedo value of the snow, thereby allowing the snow to melt. Apart from causing natural disasters, it has also got implication on the monsoon patterns along the South Asia. We all know that the monsoon in India is dependent on the pressure of the Tibetan plateaus. With the melting glacier and global warming, the warming of Tibetan plateau will become erratic, thereby causing our monsoon to be erratic phenomenon. And the countries have made a right step forward by agreeing to keep the global warming at the level of 2 degrees Celsius. Only 2 countries of the world have agreed to reduce the difference by 1.5 degrees Celsius, namely Gambia and Morocco. We should also consider the fact put forward by IPCC in its recent assessment report that even if we are sticking up with our goal, as mentioned in the Paris Agreement, the global warming will be a happening phenomenon. The country should take proactive roles in order to cut down the emission, thereby saving the natural resources for their future generations. Let's move to the next article. The next article is related with the recent proposal of disaster risk management exercise under the ambit of Indian Ocean Rim Association. Government of India is a nodal authority for this process. Let's have a look into this. Indian Ocean Rim Association is an organization of the countries which are located along the verge and the extent of Indian Ocean. This multilateral body has 22 members and 9 dialogue partners. Among the Indian Ocean Rim Association member, India is a prominent player both because of its economical and geographical positioning. The one of the important thread that is one of the thread that is connecting all the Indian Ocean region countries is that these countries are located along disaster prone region. So joint operations on disaster management and disaster mitigation becomes more imminent and important for the countries located along the Indian Ocean Rim. Keeping this in mind, the Indian Ocean Rim Association has made the disaster risk management as one core part of their action plan planned for the years between 2017 and 21. And in order to train the other countries in the disaster management, NDMA has been acting as a nodal authority, and along with Ministry of Home Affairs and External Affairs, they are organizing a meeting for Indian Ocean Rim countries in order to train them in disaster management exercises. This is an important tool through which India can exert its soft power over the Indian Ocean Rim countries. The third article is about the rising emission levels in India. Earlier it was said that the emission levels in China was higher than any other country. With rising industrialization, now India has been pipping China in the emission level. This article is speaking about the rise in emissions in Indian cities. One of the important factors for emission is transportation. Transportation is a major factor of emission after the industries. With the level of mobility happening now all over the world, it is not possible for us to cut down the transportation. But what we can do is, we can make urban planning in an effective manner that the distance between the distance traveled by the people in urban areas come down. And it was naturally expected that with urbanization, the distance between workplace and the home would become short. The distance between workplace and home would become short, thereby resulting in cut down of transportation induced emissions. But this hypothesis is not effectively applied with the present situation, present conditions of developing countries. And this factor, this improper urban planning, which has increased the transportation distance for the people living in urban areas. This improper urban planning in India, which has resulted in longer transportation distance for urban commuters, has made India to pip China as highest greenhouse gas emanator from transportation sector. The need of the hour is to develop sustainable urban planning. Also, we have to remember the fact that despite of being fourth largest greenhouse gases emitter in the world, the per capita emission in India is very low. It stands at the average of the per capita emission from India is very low. It is way lesser than the world average of 4.2 tons. According to the data given by Global Carbon Project, if this emission is growing steadily, with the recent survey undertaken by Global Carbon Project says that this carbon emissions from India, that is the per capita carbon emission, has been drastically increasing at the rate of 6%, posing a problem to the environmental security of Indians. So the government of the day should focus on building sustainable cities for the future. The fourth article is speaking about the rise of the menace of non-communicable diseases in Southeast Asia, and especially with respect to cancer. The erstwhile Southeast Asia was known for communicable disease. With the development of economic Southeast Asian countries, the lifestyle changed. With the change of lifestyle came in the menace of communicable disease. Of them, cancer is the most potent and most lethal killer disease in the Southeast Asian countries. A recent data released by WHO indicates that in the year 2018, 18.1 million new cases of cancer developed all over the world. And of that 18.1 million patients, 9.6 million people died of the disease. But the point to be noted is that apart from high death to disease ratio of cancer, another important fact is that 70% of the cancer induced death occurred in the low and middle income countries. And this low and middle income countries also include the Southeast Asian region. The changing lifestyle and changing dietary pattern is cited as an important reason for the menace of cancer in the region. the cost of treatment and the lack of infrastructure available in these countries to provide treatment for the patient are pushing the patients toward the deathbed. The inadequate access to cancer screening, diagnosis and treatment is the primary cause of deaths. Even if the people are ready to diagnose the disease earlier, they have to incur a huge fortune of their savings into the treatment. It is also pushing them into the vicious cycle of poverty. Poor health can push people into the vicious cycle of poverty, thereby placing them more vulnerable to diseases. Effective cancer screening services must be available at secondary and primary facilities in the Southeast Asian countries. And the health workers must be trained in order to identify the signs and symptoms that could lead to positive diagnosis of the patient. Positive diagnosis is most important step towards alleviating or to counter any impact created by diseases. This article is speaking about the need for funding the upkeeping of 96 elephant corridors in India. This becomes more important with the rising man-animal conflict happening in the country. Elephants are the largest herbivores in the forest ecosystem. By this, it forms the pyramid of the herbivorous animal in a forest. Apart from their role in maintaining the balance in an ecosystem, it is also acting as an heritage symbol. Indians, following the pantheistic philosophy in their religion, they do worship elephant as a god. Based on this cultural heritage values, elephant has been declared as the national heritage animal of India. Protection of elephant becomes more important in these aspects. And one of the important ways to protect the elephants in India is to protect the elephant corridors available in the different parts of the country. Elephant corridors are the pathway used by the elephants to move from one forest to another forest or from one part of a forest to another part of the forest. Securing the elephant corridor is becoming important to secure the interest of elephants in our country. In order to move forward with this initiative, five NGOs under the Wildlife Trust of India has formed Asian Elephant Alliance to provide funding for 96 elephant corridor in 12 states of the country. This Asian Elephant Alliance is formed by WTA, as I mentioned earlier. Other five NGOs participating in this alliance are Elephant Family, International Fund for Animal Welfare, IUCN Netherlands, and World Land Trust. The WTA already undertook a study in the years 2012-15. By undertaking this study, they have found that few elephant corridors need external support, and this external support were provided to the elephant corridors present in the state of Meghalaya, Assam, Kerala and Karnataka. The help is being provided by the conservation partners and with the help of state governments. The alliance is aimed at collecting funds in order to finance the development activities and in order to maintain the sustainability of the 96 elephant reserves all over the country. The last article is related with the recent controversy surrounding the angel tax for the startups. The government has been mulling to set up a panel to look into the problem. Let's have a brief look into it. There are different avenues available for an established industry to raise capital from the financial market. One important way is to raise funds from the sale of stocks. This process applies well for established companies and not for new entry into the market. Startups or new entrants into the market, and there is not enough data available for the investors to analyze about their earlier performances. And there comes the important role of valuation of the company. The startups are not evaluated based on their earlier results. Rather, they are based on the future prospects of the idea the startup is working on. So, the valuation of, since it is involving the future prospects, the valuation of the shares of a startup company is always higher than the market price. And the tax on this difference between the valuation price of the stock and the actual market price of the stock is known as the angel tax. Shares over and above the fair market value of those shares. So, this results in availability of excess capital. This excess capital is treated as income by the government and this is taxed accordingly. This tax, known as the angel tax, is restricting the company's capital flow and this is affecting the functioning of startups and the angel investors who are providing capital for these startups. These issues happened a few months earlier and now the government has considered the requests submitted by the startup companies of India and the angel investors. Now the government has proposed to relax these angel tax norms for startups. And it has set up a new panel under the control of Department for Promotion of Industry and Internal Trade to look into the matter and to suggest a measure to cut down the angel tax.